as an entrepreneurial couple, what is your participation in the businesses that are being conducted by you?
I think that's such a great tribute that a husband can pay to a wife, that he takes her common sense and her intuition very seriously.
Yes, Dharmendra, what can you add to that?
You know, to put it in the IT phrase, you know, she is the software for my business and I provide the hardware.
Dharmendra, we would like to know, as a couple, when you were engaged with the government department, with the government agencies in this country, what made you get into the entrepreneurship mode? When you were a practicing chartered accountant, you thought that I need to be at the other side of the table and enjoy the power that a government officer wields. So you became a government officer. And after that, what made you come into the entrepreneurship? What motivated you?
See, let me start with your first question. You know, what made me get into the IRS? And that was purely because one particular officer, in the course of conversation, he threw a challenge to me. You know, he started bragging about how difficult it is to pass the UPSC and, you know, blah, blah, blah. I said, okay, fine, I am up to the challenge. Now you tell me how to go about. Because being a Bombayite, you know nothing about how the Indian bureaucracy works. You do not know what UPSC is. You do not know how to get into these exams. I was in the same position. You know, my knowledge about the government services was barely minimal. So I took up the challenge and I was in constant touch with him. And he used to guide me also. He used to tell me, you take this subject, you take that subject, and it will help you. And he was amazed the way I passed. So it was a challenge that was the more inspiring thing for me.
What I would like to ask you is, there are people who are wealth creators and they live in the metro cities of this country. So you talk about successful entrepreneurs in cities like Delhi, Bombay, Calcutta, Chennai. What made you do wealth creation sitting in a two-tier city? Of course, Mangalore is a coastal rich state by itself, a city by itself. But what made you sit there and still do what somebody would have otherwise done in an urban city?
See, I'll break this question into two parts. The first part is when we decided to resign. And, you know, the entrepreneur in me was, you know, I couldn't contain it within myself. You know, it was just about to jump out of my body. But then we were about to decide where to settle down, whether to be an entrepreneur in Mumbai or whether to settle down in Mangalore. So in the course of discussion, what came out, you know, as a consensus opinion, that Mangalore that time, you know, it was a tier 3 city, not even a tier 2 city. And it gave you tremendous opportunity. You know, it was like a, you know, absolutely a virgin area for a lot of developments. So we felt that it would be better chance of succeeding at that late age. And after being set into, you know, bureaucratic way of working in Mangalore rather than in Mumbai. And we were exactly at that point in time, you know, Mangalore was just about to change itself from a town to a city. And we saw that opportunity and we felt, no, Mangalore is the right place.
The money swings in a way in this country and all the countries in the world, where money flows from the stock market to the real estate, to the bullion market, to the stock market, to the real estate. So did you intentionally plan these business models and how did you plan it?
No, I was a very keen observer of the financial markets right from the day, you know, of my college, you know. So like when I was in my third year of college, I went and asked my father, you know, I want to invest in the equity market, you know, would you give me money? He said, yes, I'll give you money, but it will have its cost. It's not going to be free. So that taught me the first lesson, you know, money always has its cost. So I said, fine, I'll take the money and I'll repay the cost. He said, it will be 2% per month.
Wow.
And that was pretty stiff. After getting money from him, you know, like, I thought, you know, where to put that money which will give me more than 2%. I went straight into the demography of India. The population is growing. At that point, it was growing at 2.3% per annum. So the simple stock which I identified was Hindustan Lever, which was an FMCG, which was entirely dependent on the demography of India. So if demography is going to grow more than 2.3%, I can easily pay my father 2% interest.
So you have got a very analytical mind. Definitely you're a chartered accountant and then 10 years service with the government department on an important position definitely makes it more analytical. Your mind becomes more analytical. So I think It was always there in you, doing an analysis and move forward. Dharmendra, what I want to ask is, I've been seeing it from long many years in India, as far as government policy decision making is concerned, whatever which doesn't work well is always given a tax exemption. When it starts working well, the government will withdraw that tax exemption. And when it runs really well, they start taxing that activity.
That's what precisely
so
the government...
How do you calculate that when you're investing? How do you mitigate that risk?
That's what precisely the government did. They withdrew the accelerated depreciation, fortunately not retrospectively, but only for the prospective wind power
generation. So retrospective is always for Vodafone.
Yeah. Even the 15 years tax exemption on the income, they withdrew only prospectively, not retrospectively, only for the new units. And unfortunately, the carbon credit market collapsed in the last 2 years. Because this carbon credit market was governed by the Kyoto Protocol on the clean environment, clean power generation. It was not renewed in the year 2012 when the period came to an end. We all would have read in the newspapers that at the Davos this Kyoto Protocol meeting was there and it failed. It didn't come to any conclusive agreement. The minute it failed, the carbon credits rates collapsed in the international market from 18 euros to today it is only 10 cents per carbon credit. So anybody who has any idea of investing in wind power today, it is economically not viable unless and until you are a Japanese investor where your rate of interest is very low for the funds. Because today with the, if you look at the calculations, you will be earning 9% to 10% on your wind power investment, which is way below your rate of borrowing, which will be around 12%. So it's just not economically viable as of today.
Giselle, you also as a family decided to get into the airlines business. You also got a license from the government and you all were on the verge, you all took two aircrafts and you all were on the verge to get them operational. What went wrong? Why didn't you begin? What was the learning in that? As a couple, I'm sure you must have discussed amongst yourselves and got answers.
Yes, in fact, it seemed like a very ambitious thing to do. Of course, a great decision if things worked. But the way we looked at fuel prices skyrocketing and so forth, it just didn't seem viable. Again, the math seemed to be totally loaded against such a very ambitious enterprise. So compared to the big barons with very deep pockets, it seemed to be a wise time to say goodbye to the initial investment, but get out of the business.
So you booked the loss. Fantastic. I think that is a very big takeaway that as an entrepreneur, you need to always keep controlling your ego and not just to please the world that you dig holes in your pockets. So I think that's a very, very big takeaway. Giselle, tell me, of all the business ventures that you all have done till now, what excites you the most? Is it power generation? Is it real estate, that is construction? Is it any other industry that you are invested into? What excites you the most and why?
I think construction, because at the end I'm a person who's hooked on beauty and what we bring out in the end is extremely aesthetic. And at the same time, you know that you're really transforming lifestyles. You're transforming an entire place. For instance, maybe construction in Bombay is no big deal because there's a huge metropolis here of people wanting to live. But when you give that in a smaller space, you're a magnet for people to move from congested cities to move back from, say, foreign employments or retirements and assure them that they're going to have a very good lifestyle. And that is particularly apparent in the mall that we co-promoted. Because you see, people who live in non-metros, they always have that slight feeling of inadequacy compared to people who have lived in metros or those who live in foreign countries. It's always such a point of pleasure to expect and accept gifts from people who come from elsewhere. When you have a mall purveying international brands in a smaller space, it completely transforms the outlook of people. It totally takes their confidence level up. And in itself, it is a magnet for further growth to take place, you know, on the basis of the fact that you have certain facilities in a non-metro. More people are encouraged to come. So you can totally transform a space, a modest space, to one of much higher potential in terms of attracting quality human resources back to perhaps their place of origin and even from elsewhere.
Dharmendra, I would like to ask you one question. When the numbers were screaming at you in the airlines industry, you pulled the plug and you exited. When you built the first mall in Bangalore, the whole country was screaming that mall business is no more profitable. You knew those statistics, you did your study nationally, and even then you went ahead and built the mall. So what was the thoughts behind those decisions?
I will go back a little before the mall. This was the year 2003, when the first wave of liberalization happened in the banking and insurance businesses and telecom businesses. And you could see, you know, various new companies coming into telecom, insurance and various financial products through the banking sector into the big cities like Bombay and Bangalore and various other cities. The simple logic, the simple intelligence told me, finally, if these businesses have to grow and they have to sustain, they have to come out of metros and come into the tier 2 and tier 3 cities. That was the time when I started with Maximus Commercial Complex. It was the first financial center in Mangalore, you know, ever built. Because earlier the concept of a commercial building was, you know, a small commercial building where some small offices of
like
doctors,
building,
you know, doctors, engineers and others would be there. So this was the first concept where I came out with a financial center, where it will be only given to companies which are dealing into the financial sector. And that was the time when everyone in Mangalore told me, see, you have great ideas, you are perhaps overqualified for Mangalore, it may not succeed. But in the end, the economic cycle has to take its shape, and all the big companies, whether they are into insurance or mutual fund or telecom or banking, they all came to Mangalore. And this particular commercial complex was a big success.
Thanks a lot, Dharmendra and Giselle. That was very brilliant. And thanks a lot for sharing everything that you experienced in your business career. Please. One for the photo.